Thank you so much for joining me. Quelle surprise! After I did my Afri Orchids update 2 days later, I've got roots on my Lelia furfuracea. So this is going to be me potting her up according to what I believe I can do for this orchid, because Lelia furfuracea likes to have bark, be mounted on tree fern, none of which I have here on my table. Because, well, Lelia furfuracea also likes to have high humidity, none of which I have for 8 or so months in my climate here in southern Spain. So I am going to treat my Lelia furfuracea as if she is a rapiculous Lelia. Isn't that a sight to behold? Just a couple of days after my update. Yep, I'm going to pot her up as if I were treating her like a rapiculous Lelia, even though she isn't one. But with little pseudobulbs like this, I think she will look very, very nice in the same setup with the same treatment. So what I'm going to do first is explain what I'm thinking here, right? That looks really, really good from dimensions and everything. And I would love to go ahead with that. But the length of the roots is showing me something that I want to be able to, let's say, preempt for many, many years to come. And that's why she's going into a pot where she's going to look ridiculous for many, many years to come. But I am hedging my bets on these roots. You see, they are not branching. They're not real happy branchers, but they're long. If I put her in this pot, yeah, she'll be pot bound pretty, pretty quickly, but I also have another candidate I'm kind of hoping that will survive while it's trying to acclimate that would be much better suited for this little pot. So I am going to put Lelia furfuracea into this big pot based on the potential of the roots, which we've got more coming. When I saw these, I was so excited. It was like getting a Christmas present in the middle of summer. Being a cold grower, 2,100 meters to 3,000 meters. Yeah, she's not really in her happy place here at this time of year, because I am averaging now 30 degrees Celsius. So what I want to do first is clean up that little bit of a sheath thing there that I have on the pseudobulb. I'm just gonna get my toothbrush and stay away from those root nubbins, but get that off. This is so exciting. And I'm sure she's gonna do great as a rapiculous Lelia setup. And she's gonna look really, really silly. But I am thinking ahead positively. So these blooms are supposedly very long lasting and very, very fragrant, apparently. If they're long lasting, that was already the most important sales point that I had when it said long lasting blooms. I'm like, okay, she was pricey. She cost me 40 euros. Yeah, for these three little bulbs. But I think she's going to be worth it. So, all that being said, let's get to business. Pot. I don't want to be using large lava rock to crock this, because I don't have much lava rock left and I really don't want to buy any more in. So I'm using my dirty lekka, the broken bits that I can't use for regular repots. I'm going to fill the base in with that. I do not anticipate to have to deal with this orchid for a long, long time. Right, the next thing I want to do is use my Akadama as my wicking agent, but I have also mixed that in a lot with grit, because I don't want it so wet for her. I don't want to be losing any roots to high, high moist environment. If she likes to have bark and tree fern, she likes the humidity a tree fern can provide, but clearly, by the sounds of what it's telling me, she likes air around her roots. So this is almost a 60-40 ratio, 60 being the grit, 40 being the Akadama. get that twig out there. Right, so we've come to this point. Just gonna make sure where my holes are back there, and I'm gonna get my tag in place already. I know where the roots are gonna go, but I want that in place instead of messing around, because what happens next is the orchid is going to go into place and into position, but I don't want to be stabbing around on any roots that I feel could be going rogue. I don't like how that root is sticking out, so we'll take care. Are you in the middle? Yeah, we'll take care of this corner right now with just lava rock. And this corner as well. I'm really, really mindful of those root tips. That's why I'm uber cautious, and I'm gonna take it nice and slow. And I'm gonna thank you so much for your time. There she is, for being here while I take things nice and slow. So now she is in place, and I want to make sure that the roots that are going to grow down into the media have enough air around them. Again, tree fern bark, humidity, but air. So that is going to be my next layer for her. And she still looks a little bit low in the pot, and we'll fix that shortly. But first of all, before we fix it, I'm going to add more Akadama and grit in between the crevices. This is my humidity around the roots. We've provided air because of the lava rock. Now we're going to add humidity and the wicking factor of the setup being semi-hydro. That is the Akadama. So I'm really creating like a recipe here and hope that she'll be happy with it. We'll give it a little bit of a jiggle and raise her up. And now I need a little bit more lava rock on the other side again to prop her up. It's like a layer cake. I have medium-sized lava rock for this project because I want a lot of air around her. I don't want to suffocate the roots, so I took medium lava rock so that I could simulate that. It is water retentive moisture and holds on to its moisture really well. And the only reason I've got Akadama going on in this pot, once again, is for the wicking. And then this will eventually fall into the crevices, but it will provide enough humidity around the roots the way I have been keeping her in the past month since I've received her. Not even a month. 3 weeks, and she was doing this, and I only had her in water, and I drained the water out for the nighttime, and then she dried. Sometimes I had seaweed and calcium and magnesium, and sometimes just plain water. When I saw the roots forming, I backed off on the seaweed because we had done our job. She's growing roots, and the rest is now up to her to find her way into the pot. Now, do I want more lava rock on the surface? Or let's have a look-see how she is looking once I flush her through. Let's get ourselves into position with a base color and make sure we don't douse any of the Anselia Africanas down there. All right, let's give her some water. Let's just have a look-see and check the color of the water as it comes out. That's nice and clear. I do the base color for the drain holes because I want to make sure that I keep the quality and the degrading of the Akadama under control. Akadama will not degrade as fast in my climate because I don't have freezing temperatures. This orchid will be living outside here with me, with the Rapiculus lelias all year round, which is great, but I want to have a base color on the water so that I can keep tabs on what is happening with the Akadama inside the pot. And if that were to ever change and go a little bit brown, I know the Akadama is breaking down. Am I worried that I'm gonna suffocate the roots? Not at all, not one bit, because I've used larger lava rock in this instance. It'll never ever suffocate the roots. If the roots get long enough and then go into the reservoir, for example, then they will be like water roots. And if there is degraded Akadama in that reservoir, eventually with the flushing, it is going to be so fine grade that it will just flush out of the holes. So basically, I am not concerned at all about this setup. And I won't be adding any lava rock on the surface just yet. She is safe in the pot. I can see how the roots are going to be performing. I can mist around the edge right here, and I don't have to go into the base, and then the Akadama will wick the water into the center. She isn't quite centered in the pot. I don't think that's going to be a problem for many years to come anyway. She looks a little bit silly, but I am so proud of my little Lelia Fuforacea to actually have grown roots under these conditions, considering she's a cold grower. Again, 2,100 meters up to 3,000 meters. In the middle of the summer in Spain. What a trooper. I have high hopes for her and I'm excited to see what she does next, because normally she should be resting. She came from South Africa and it is winter there now. So if this is her winter habit, then I have to consider she is in winter mode and producing roots. Her winter mode normally is no water, a drier kind of a period, depending on the humidity. So again, it's going to be a fine little balance for me to get it right. She's growing roots. I'm not going to be keeping her as wet anymore. I want to see and learn if her root growth is based on the winter being cooler and her bio clock is on a different setting at the moment. So there's a lot to learn right now according to what she does and what her habits are. Has she already acclimated and thinks, woohoo, it's hot? I'm going to grow? I don't know. We shall wait and see. It's all part of the exciting process of getting to know your orchid. So in my head, I'm thinking she's completely and fully in winter mode. I'm just grateful I have her in root production mode. Thank you very, very much for watching. I'm going to be very, very excited to keep this little orchid in the viewfinder and make sure that we follow her little journey and see what she does apart from growing roots now, and what her growth habit is based on the season. Which season does she find herself in, and why is she doing what she's doing when it's far too hot for what she would prefer? Aren't orchids fascinating? Oh, I love them. Have yourselves a wonderful day, everybody. Really, really appreciate your time. Thank you so much for being here. Please stay safe. Hope to see you in the next video. Take care. Bye.